People moving out, people moving in. Why? Because of the color of the skin. Run, 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 but you sure can't hide. Well, nobody's interested in learning but the teacher. Segregation, determination, demonstration, integration, aggravation, humiliation, obligation to my nation.
Welcome to Detroit Wants to Know. It's been a banner week in Detroit. Number one, our new emergency financial manager is on the job. Number two, right to work. That legislation that went through last fall and was passed in lame duck session, it was made into law. Ladies and gentlemen, it is in effect now. So that affects all these binding contracts. But what's even worse, my good friends, is that Mr. Fucano has managed to make Detroit more lawless than it already is. How do you say? Well, he's been cutting the prosecutor's budget. The prosecutor does not, Prosecutor Kim Worthy does not have the staff to go cover cases in 36th District Court. So if you have a DUI, if you've been speeding as far as a misdemeanor, there's no prosecutor there. They're dismissing whole courtrooms. This cannot be tolerated. Mr. Fucano, you need to tell us what your appointees do. And I asked you to do this last year. Just start with two of them, all right? Tell us what John Barden does for a living. Tell us what Miles Handy does for a living, and justify their salaries and whatever it is those two do against two prosecutors, at least two prosecutors, because I know those guys are hefty paid. Now, my main man, Fred Berry, he took it on the sword. He decided not to go forward with his contract to drive your car and wash your car and take care of you while he was earning a retirement. Hats off to you, Fred Berry. You're the man. Mr. Fucano, you have managed to make Detroit more lawless on top of giving us blight. The old county courthouse still stands vacant while you're in the Taj Mahal called the Guardian Building. No sense. You overspent on the Guardian Building. You've wasted our money. And what about that racetrack? You spent $20 million on infrastructure there? And then let's talk about the new jail. Now, you know, Mr. Fucano, you were supposed to make that a jail and a courthouse. But no, you and your infinite wisdom decided just to build a jail, and now you still have to build a courthouse, and the jail you're building is $50 million over budget. Mr. Fucano, don't even try to run for re-election next year after what you've done to our city. It's not lawless Livonia, it's lawless Detroit, it's blighted Detroit, and it's because of you. When I come back, I'm gonna introduce you to the man that collects the taxes to pay for Mr. Fucano's bungling. It's crazy. When I come back, it's my man, Deputy Treasurer Dave Szmanski.
The future of healthcare is taking shape right near you. It's DMC Cardio Team One doctors working with the world's smallest heart pump. It's patient smart rooms that communicate through smart technology. It's electronic medical records so DMC specialists and your personal doctors work together so care is centered around you. DMC's $850 million investment is coming to life, but much of the future is already here. DMC, for 150 years, always there.
Detroit Wants to Know is sponsored by the AFPD, the voice of independent retailers.
Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. In my last segment, I talked to you about how Mr. Fucano has blown it in this county and blown your money. Let me show you where the money comes from. Let me introduce you to the man that collects the money that funds Mr. Ficano's tomfoolery. Deputy Treasurer Szmanski, how are you?
My pleasure to be here.
This morning is D-Day. This is the last day to pay D-taxes.
It is D-Day, that's for sure, because what happens is we've already been to Wayne County Circuit Court. We've been receiving orders from the court for closing on properties, and the Treasurer Wojtowicz has said many times he doesn't want to take anybody's property, but we have to have people come into our office and work with us. And later today is really, it's the last day of March, and that order becomes unappealable. And so we need those people to come in and take care of their taxes.
What time do you open this morning?
8 o'clock.
You open at 8 o'clock, so we've got, 6 hours from now. People can get a little bit of sleep, go get that money together and come. Can they bring you a check, write you a check?
Well, if they're paying their 2012 taxes, they can write us a personal check or bring a business check. If it's anything before 2012, we require certified funds. They can bring either cash, and if they bring cash, I always tell people, don't give the cash to anybody but a cashier at the cashier's window. We've got some scam artists there who are taking people's money. We try and get them as often as we can, but some people lose their money. So they can pay with a personal check for the 2012 taxes. Otherwise, we need certified funds or cash.
How many houses have gone into foreclosure, have gone through the circuit court process for 2010?
42,000 properties.
42,000. Now, is that 2,000 down from last year, is my math?
No, that's the same as last year.
It's the same as last year.
But now, last year, we were able to help 23,000 people avoid foreclosure, and this year, we're hoping to do better than that. And so our staff is working tirelessly trying to help people avoid foreclosure. And we've got plans that are available for them. We have a distressed owner-occupant extension for somebody who owns a home and lives in a home. Mm-hmm. If they owe only 2010 and later taxes, nothing before 2010, mm-hmm. they would pay 10% of the 2010 taxes, and then they'd have through the year to pay the rest of the taxes. Now, those people also may qualify for this fabulous program from the state of Michigan called Step Forward Michigan. Mm-hmm. And they would go to their website, stepforwardmichigan.org. And if they've suffered what's called an involuntary financial hardship, and they have an income so they could pay their taxes going forward, the state, using federal funds, may actually loan them the money interest-free to pay off their taxes. And the cool thing about this is if they continue to live in their home, each year they live in their home, they'll forgive 20% of the debt. So if they stay in their home for 5 years, they no longer owe those taxes. So we really encourage anybody who owns a home and lives in it to at least explore stepforwardmichigan.org. So we've got the Distressed Owner Occupant Extension, stepforwardmichigan.org. We've also got a stipulated payment agreement, and that's where we take the taxes for 2010 and any period prior, put them together. They'd pay 40% of those now because they should have really been here 2 months ago, but they'll pay 40% of those now. And we'll put them on a payment plan to help them pay that throughout the rest of the year. It's important, though, for people to understand, as you asked at the outset, if they owe taxes from before 2012, we need certified funds.
You need certified funds in 6 hours, starting in 6 hours. That's if you aren't there, you got to go. Can people still cut a deal on this last D-Day?
Well, when you talk about cutting a deal, it's very important.
We're talking about the payment arrangements and all that, the 20% down, the 40% down. Can they still do this on this last day?
They certainly can. We're going to have staff, and I really encourage anybody who's coming down today to bring a book, because lines will get very long. We've got 15 cashiers who'll be working nonstop. We've got other staff. Our staff works tirelessly to try and help people. And one thing I want to really mention is, the method in which the public treats us is nothing short of spectacular. People give our citizens a hard time because they didn't pay their taxes. Well, we understand they didn't create the economic calamity. They're coming down, and our staff treats them with respect, and the amount of respect they give to our staff is fabulous. Okay. It's really a wonderful relationship.
Well, so people don't go around hating you. All you and Treasurer Wytovich do is collect the taxes.
That's our
job. That is your statutory job.
We have to do that, and consistent with that, we want to keep people in their homes.
So when we don't have prosecutors and we don't have people in jail space, it's not your fault. You're just statutory required to collect the taxes.
We collect, they spend.
They spend. So it's like a husband and a wife. You're the husband, you go get the cash, and the wife goes spends it. Now, but in modern homes, it sometimes is now the wife goes
sometimes
and makes the money, and the husband goes spends it.
Yeah.
Fecano, the hermaphrodite, he can either be a husband or a wife.
Well, I'm not going to go there, but you know, it is important for people to understand that in Wayne County government, we have five constitutionally created by the state of Michigan offices: the sheriff, the treasurer, the register of deeds, the clerk, the prosecutor, and we don't work for the county commission or for the executive. We work with them to serve the people.
Okay. Deputy Treasurer, thanks for coming.
My pleasure.
Ladies and gentlemen, when we come back, it's Reverend Williams. This is a bad week for Reverend Williams. He fought, he lost weight, and everything he fought for, he lost. We'll be right back.
No one ever thinks that a serious injury can happen to them, but it can, and it does, and it can happen to you. And when it does, you need a fighter in that courtroom for you. Call me, Ben Johnson. Automobile accident, police misconduct, medical malpractice, product liability. You know what you're up against, how hard it is to get answers. When all you want is justice, call me, Ben Johnson. Whatever your legal crisis, I will fight for you. Call me today.
Double action. Shooting Center and Gun Shop for the largest selection of guns, accessories, and ammunition. Double Action is your only pro gun shop. We have a highly trained staff who will find the right gun for you, new or used. Our indoor climate-controlled shooting center is the largest in the Midwest, including a pistol range and 50-yard rifle range. For ammunition at a great price, repairs done by experts, and a selection that can't be matched. Double Action. We're on DeQuinder in Madison Heights.
Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. Last fall, all of last year, my main man, Reverend Charles Williams of the historic King Solomon Baptist Church, fought to stop right to work. He fought to stop the EM, and he lost both of them. I'm going to ask him right now, Reverend, welcome, and how do you feel? You lost both fights, and you lost some weight.
You literally gave
your pound of flesh for the people.
Well, you know, I decided to choose a new lifestyle in terms of my eating habits, and no longer do I eat bread and meat, just vegetables. But I will say this: we have not lost yet. The battle is still ours. We're not going to give up now.
How is the battle still yours when the EM was installed earlier this week, and right to work just went active this week?
Well, it goes active,
When this show airs, it's active.
It will be active. However, we're going to continue the fight. We're going to the courts. We're putting right to work in the courts. We're putting emergency management in the courts.
Federal?
And we're putting them in the federal courts. We're continuing the call for federal intervention. As you know, when Dr. King was fighting against segregation laws and Jim Crow laws, we needed federal intervention from Robert Kimney, who was the United States Department of Justice Attorney General at that time. So we're doing the same thing. We need Eric Holder to step in. We need him to do that, to take his billion-dollar operation and the government dime to fight against what we feel like is an injustice. We feel, very frankly, that this is anti-democratic legislation, and it is an attack on our voting rights. And at no point and at no place, no whether it's 18 months or 6 months, do I want to give up my right to vote, give up my right to hold my elected officials accountable. And as of now, with a bureaucrat in office, we cannot hold the bureaucrat accountable. We simply can only talk to the governor.
You're talking about Mr. Orr, but I've got a question for you. In Sandy Hook, mm-hmm. 20 darling little children were killed by a madman. Mm-hmm. President swooped in. Last year in Detroit, 412 people were killed in Detroit. Mm-hmm. Violent crime. No swooping in. Do you really think the federal government's going to step in on this?
Well, let me correct you on something here. First of all, 412 people here killed by violent crime. That played a role in making sure that we had a voice in the legislation. When the president talks about gun bill, he doesn't just talk about gun bill for Sandy Hook. He talks about gun bill for the rest of the United States. And in fact, as a result of our activism, the National Executive Director for our organization, National Action Network, she is on the task force for Joe Biden's task force for gun legislation. So, as you know and heard yesterday, there are some advances that are being made around gun violence and around the gun legislation bill. There's some disadvantages, some advantages, but we've got to continue to fight. One thing that you understand and that you said very clearly is that when something gets dramatized, the presidents respond. The president responded to the dramatization of 20 children getting killed. The president responded to the dramatization of thousands of people showing up to Washington, D.C. at Martin Luther King speaks. The president shows up to dramatization around many different issues. And so Detroiters, when people say, well, Reverend, that protesting is old, people don't do that anymore. No. If we show up and we dramatize the issue and the importance of the issue, then we get response. And so that's the reason why we're going to continue to fight. We're going to continue to march and demonstrate. And there are those who will even decide to take civil disobedience in their hands and go to jail for a change.
So, and when you say that, take civil disobedience into their hands, so can we expect occupying of the Coleman A. Young Center?
You can expect the occupation of the Coleman A. Young Center. You can expect those who will seek to get arrested. Mm-hmm. You will even expect more people who will join the traffic slowdowns.
You all did the traffic slowdowns. You were impeding people going to work. What if I was trying to drive an ambulance down the freeway and you all had the traffic slowed down?
Well, when they were marching down the roads of Birmingham where they were getting dogs and water hoses, there might have been a house burning somewhere else, but they were firemen taking the water hose to hit little kids. I mean, dramatization and display of action is what we're calling for. And I think that the inconvenience of that is definitely a part of dramatization and showing the distaste and the disgust of emergency management. Understand, Nick, it's not over, and we will continue to fight it. We'll continue to stand up and stand out.
Okay, we're gonna go to break. We're gonna talk about the EFM when we come back. Ladies and gentlemen, when I come back, it's more with Reverend Williams. Pastor, we'll be right back.
I couldn't get out of the car. I couldn't run or exercise. I couldn't work.
Dr. Lewis Radin believes that pain shouldn't have to wait. His Spine Specialists of Michigan is a comprehensive center dedicated to helping you manage pain now. Expect the latest techniques and personalized care. Why suffer another minute?
He's the best. I tell people that he's the one that saved my life.
Make your appointment with Dr. Radin. Call 248-792-9496.
Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. My guest is Reverend Williams. Reverend Williams, in our last segment, you talked about civil disobedience, mm-hmm. occupying the city mm-hmm. hall, stopping, drawing attention to the new EFM. Mm-hmm. Reverend Williams, let me tell you, Detroit, you know, a lot of people that are talking about this aren't from here. Mm-hmm. I have to drive through streets where the lights are out. Mm-hmm. I have to deal with a crime-ridden situation, which has been made even worse by Mr. Fecano not funding the prosecutor correctly. Pastor Williams, the solution, I don't see the solution is going back to letting Dave Bing control things. I don't see the solution as being letting the city council control things because they've blown it. They had 3 years. And if they had started off with the promise and kept to the promise they'd had, I maintain we wouldn't be here right now. So give me a solution other than going back to their control that is short of emergency management. What is going to make this place better?
Well, first of all, let's understand this. You cannot solve a 40-year problem in 3 years. You can't solve a 4-year problem in 30 minutes. That's like trying to solve a 4-year problem in 30
minutes. So you're saying Dave Bing needs more time?
What I'm saying to you is that democracy has worked for the last 200 years. I don't understand why all of a sudden people don't believe it works. This is 2013. This year, we have the right and the ability to elect a brand new city council, of which we are going back to districts we haven't been there in a very long time, and we have an ability to elect a brand new mayor.
But that's 10 months.
With brand new charter implications.
But that's 10 months before they're seated. We don't have 10 months.
Let me finish. We have the ability to elect new leadership to run this city. First and foremost, democracy does work. Secondly, in the short term, what needs to happen, and this is what the emergency manager is all about, he's simply put there to do one thing, and that's to protect the interests of the banks. He's going to bust down city services, so the services that you say you appreciate or halfway appreciate or don't appreciate because you don't see there, he will define the line of whether they'll be there or not. Some people over there on the way east side of Detroit, your lights will be cut off and there'll be nothing you can do about it. Your garbage will go to once a month, and there'll be nothing you can do about it. Same things for some folks who live in Brightmoor or way on the west side of Detroit. Your lights will be cut off, and there'll be nothing. Why? Because your voice and your vote is gone. The emergency manager runs all of that, and he can operate in a vacuum without having to listen or even care about what you feel. And that is the difference between having an emergency manager and having a city council or a mayor. Now, the second piece of this is that the city council and the mayor, if the power was still in their hands, my suggestion would be is to go to these banks, the same ones that we bailed out at $1.7 trillion just 4 years ago, and say, hey, we need you to renegotiate the debt. If we can take our tax dollars, and we can bail you out, then obviously you can take the tax dollars that we bailed you out and help Main Street. We need a bailout for Main Street. We need the banks to renegotiate the debt that Main Street owes or municipalities. City of Detroit is not the only city. I don't care what no one says, the governor's wrong. The city of Detroit is not the only city that's dealing with financial debt and fiscal crisis and everything else that is happening in Cleveland, Atlanta, Philadelphia, and everywhere else across the country. And so there is a disconnect between the bailout that we gave the banks and also between the bailout that we gave Wall Street and what's happening in municipalities across the country. Not to mention we bailed out the auto industry too, which in turn helped the banks again.
You know, I would be right there with you if we could elect a mayor today, have him seated tomorrow. But the truth of the matter is we're going to elect a mayor next November. They're going to be seated the month after that. And then they're still going to take about 30 to 60 days to actually get their feet wet. Mm-hmm. All right. That is 10 to 12 months before we really see a change here in leadership. I don't think Detroit can wait that long. And let me tell you, the plans that I've seen on the table by the candidates right now, I don't see any operational changes that will eliminate the cash burn. Because even if we get the money that we are due from the state, if we don't have the operational changes inside, we're going to burn cash at that rate and we'll still be in the same problem.
But when the people like you and like others who have been standing up hold accountable our elected leadership, we can push them and urge them to handle the business that we need them to handle in terms of dealing with the banks and in terms of making sure that they provide better services and making sure that we do not burn through our cash.
I want to continue this argument later. Right. I want to see what happens when you go to jail. That'll be interesting. Ladies and gentlemen, when we come back, Brittany Mabry is going to take us into the world of the spoken word. You're going to really enjoy this. We'll be right back.
Don't let legal problems destroy your family or your life. Get the justice you deserve. I'm Sabrina Cronin of the Cronin Law Firm, and I'm here to make things right. My firm handles family law, business law, and even criminal law. We can handle all of your legal needs. So whatever you're facing, I'm here to get you justice. You can't afford not to call. Call 855-CRONIN-LAW today.
Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. As Steve said going into our break, I'm here and I'm going to introduce you to a new world, a world of the spoken word. I have my guest with me, Satori Shakoor. Thank you very much. Nice to meet you.
Thank you for
now,
having me.
You are a titled storyteller. Tell us what that means.
Well, I am a main stage moth storyteller and host. I don't know whether you're familiar with the moth.
Nope.
The Moth is an organization dedicated to the art and craft of storytelling. They have a Peabody Award-winning show on National Public Radio. Mm-hmm. That's WDET in Detroit, Michigan Radio around Michigan. And they do live storytelling on the air.
Okay.
I came through the Cliff Bell Story Slam process. I won, went to the Grand Slam at the gym, didn't win, but the Moth thought that I should host the Ann Arbor Story Slam. So I installed as a host. 2 weeks later, they asked me, would I tell a story at the Fillmore? And Charles Pugh was on that storytelling show, where they bring people from all over the country to tell a 10-minute story, true. I did that. They asked me, oh, we would like you to do your story on the Moth Radio Hour. So I went to New York and I performed my story. Since then, I've gone all over the country telling stories to audiences of 900 to 3,000 people, and they flock in and they pay $40, $50, $75 to sit there and hear five storytellers tell a true story. I'm an artist, I'm a social entrepreneur, and when I walked out on the stage in Boston on April 10th last year, I knew that I had walked into my purpose. As I was somewhere in the middle of my story, I saw that everybody in that audience was connected to the teller, and I was connected to them, and I looked at Detroit. How many people have moved out? 300,000 people.
Yes.
We have pockets of people. We have a so-called community, but who are they? My three friends and the people on Facebook.
Right.
So I thought, as a social entrepreneur, how could I use storytelling to connect Detroit and the greater Detroit area? Because I see in the future, Detroit is going to be a very diverse city, ethnically, racially, and everything. So we might as well prepare ourselves to be in the same room and connect to our shared humanity. And that's what I did. I started the Secret Society of Twisted Storytellers at the Abriac Theater, 50 seats, in July, and now
right.
we're We've gone to the Charles Wright. And
tell us all about this. Now, this is your most recent work of art.
Yes.
And tell us about it. It's the Secret Society of
Twisted Storytellers.
Okay. Tell us all about that one.
The Secret Society of Twisted Storytellers is an event. Mm-hmm. And our next one is tomorrow night at the Northwest Activity Center. Doors open at 7. The show starts at 8. We have six storytellers. One is coming from New York City, a gentleman and his producing partner, filmmaker Cedric Hill, who is coming here to buy 4 or 5 houses or properties to make film sets. He's an indie filmmaker.
Okay.
He heard my story on the podcast, which goes all over the world, and he contacted me and said, tell me about Detroit, I'm coming there. I said, come tell a story. Reverend Horace Sheffield told a story at our last event. Butch Hollowell is the musical guest with his son. So we bring real Detroiters, Huntington Woods and everywhere, to come tell a 10-minute story so we can know our neighbors and know that we have more in common than we don't.
Than we could ever imagine.
Yeah.
So let me ask you this. You've traveled across the world. You've
yes.
worked with some amazing artists.
Yes.
Luther Vandross, Sly Stone, just to name a few. Mm-hmm. You could go anywhere. What yeah. makes you want to be here in Detroit?
Well, I was born and raised in Detroit. I went to Cass Technical High School, Michigan State University. I'm a 2008 graduate of Wayne. I toured the world with Parliament Funkadelic. I'm one of the brides of Funkenstein. But a tragedy, I was living in Toronto. I'm a Canadian citizen as well. Mm-hmm. My life would have continued in Toronto as an actor, performer, producer, founder of a theater company. But there was a tragedy. My son was involved in a very tragic accident, which he suffered a brain injury.
Mm-hmm.
And subsequently, he died in 2006. After he got pretty well, I was traveling all over. I had a suitcase by the door. Can you go here, go there? I was literally not here.
Mm-hmm.
So for anybody that lives in Detroit and you're kind of, even if you think you don't have a choice, whether you think you have a choice or not, you can always choose. So I chose Detroit maybe 6 years after I was living here, chose to be here.
Thank you very much. We'll be right back, guys, with Get Up and Enjoy Detroit.
Get Up and Enjoy Detroit is brought to you by the Detroit Seafood Market.
Welcome back to Detroit Wants to Know. Brittany, that was a wonderful interview you did.
Thank you,
with
Steven.
The spoken word.
Yes.
I don't think people think enough these days. I think that type of stuff elevates us culturally. What do you think about that?
I agree. I think that we need to expand our horizons. We need to be trying to do more things than go to whatever that we shouldn't be doing. If you take time and you have something to, you don't have anything to do, you go listen to these stories. You might learn something. They're true stories by people from different walks of life, and you might get to live someone else's life just for a few minutes.
Awesome. And I'm glad she was a bride of Funkenstein.
That's pretty cool.
Ladies and gentlemen, you can catch us at SteveHoodDetroit.com. I want to thank you for watching. Also, you can see us at Detroit Uncovered, the replay. You can also go to our YouTube channel and watch all of our hits. Brittany, we're almost up to 52,000. Steve Hood, Detroit channel at YouTube. You all have an awesome week, and get up and pay them taxes. Don't lose your house. And I know it funds Mr. Ficano's largesse, but you got to do it. It's the law. Stay in your house. Have a great week.